Welcome to Concepts of Programming Languages. In this video, I want to talk about functions and their definition. And I would start with the lambda calculus. So let's start with functions. Suppose you have the real, no, the whole numbers. And this is the set consisting of all the positive and the negative and zero. Now you can consider functions from whole numbers to whole numbers. And so what you typically then write down is if you want to say f is a function from whole numbers to whole numbers, then you write it as f is something that takes an argument being a whole number and produces a whole number. And we write down f x to mean that the argument x is supplied to the function f. So this here denotes then the value of the function f. And this is the typical way you write it down. But how do you specify a function? How do you give a clear unambiguous meaning to a function? Well, you could use, for instance, equations. It is possible to say what is a property that should hold of your function. I could, for instance, define the function f by saying, well, if you have f and you have the argument x, then the resulting value of the function f with argument x must equal to x plus 1. But I could also give other kinds of properties. I could, for instance, require of the function that if its argument is x minus 1, then the result of the function must be x. Or I could say, well, if the argument is even, then the result of the function must be half of it. And there are different kinds of properties, and you can maybe see, well, that you can specify functions in quite complex ways. But then the question arises, when is a function properly defined? When do you say that you define a function? What is a definition of a function? Well, a definition of a function pinpoints. So it is clear that the function has a particular meaning and there is no way to interpret it differently. It is an unambiguous specification. So more formally, you could say a definition of a function must consist of first its specification, such as you have seen previously being a property, and furthermore, a convincing argument, proof, that actually a function exists that satisfies the function specification, and furthermore, to remove ambiguity, that there is only one function that satisfies the specification, or formally, that for every function that satisfies the specification, these functions must be the same. So let's have a look at the examples again then. If you, for instance, consider the first function specification, does this define function f? F of x, of f applied to the argument x, is x plus 1. Well, what is the function that you here intend? Well, given, for instance, 1, this function f maps it to 2. And 2 is mapped to 3, 3 is mapped to 4. So it is the successor function, as it is called. It maps every whole number to the next whole number. And there is only one such successor function. So this is perfectly fine. This specification is a definition. And then the reader of that definition has to convince him or herself that this indeed is a definition by proving that the function that it specifies exists and that the function that is specified is unique. Now the second specification, fx minus 1 equals x, is that a specification? Or sorry, is that a definition? Well, look at the specification. Consider, for instance, plugging in as an argument 3. Well, 3 equals x minus 1. Well, then x must be 4, because 4 minus 1 is 3. So then you see, okay, 3 is mapped to 4. But if you supply in maybe a different number, like 8, well, x minus 1 equals 8, then x must be 9. So this is the same function. It's the successor function. And we know the successor function is unique. So also this specification is fine as a definition. So although for a definition it is required the function is unique, it is not the case that for a function it is necessary that its specification is unique. Okay, so let's look at the last example. So here we have a function definition. Is it a definition? Well, let's figure it out. We have a specification. Does there exist a function with this specification? Sure, I mean, what does it say? If the argument is even, so it is divisible by 2, then I could split it out, saying the argument is 2 times x, and then the result must be x. So if the argument is even, then the function is the result. The result of the function is the argument divided by 2. But what if the argument is odd? Then this specification does not say anything about it. So you can now imagine that indeed the function exists. Whenever it's even, you divide it by 2, and whenever it's 2, you divide it by 2. Whenever it's even, you divide it by 2, and whenever it's odd, you also divide it by 2. Fine. But that's not the only function that satisfies this specification. You could also imagine a function for all odd numbers that are all mapped to, for instance, the number 0. And that's different from the other functions. So there are multiple different functions that satisfy this specification. So the last one cannot be used as a definition. Okay. So now let's have a look at an interesting notion, namely the notion of a recursive definition. The idea of recursion is that a function appears multiple times or repeatedly. So whenever you have a function specification in which the function occurs multiple times, it could be a recursive definition, or it is a recursive definition. If it is a definition, is this a definition? Okay, so we have fx, and then we say f of x is equal to 2 times f of x minus 1. So it is clear that the f here, the function f, recurses because it occurs at multiple places. And whenever we want to solve with this equation, whenever you encounter the f, you can replace it, for instance, by this equality. And so then you keep on encountering the f. But now, is this a definition? Is this function specification a definition? Two possibilities that we have to check. Two conditions that we have to check. One, a proof exists that shows that a function actually exists that satisfies this specification. And number two is that the functions that satisfy the specifications are all the same. So the function is unique, uniquely defined. Okay, does there exist a function? Well, suppose there exists a function. Well, analyze that function then, and you will see that for an arbitrary y, f of y, no, the argument y applied to f, sorry, it cannot be odd. Why not? Well, fy must be equal, according to the specification, to 2 times fy minus 1. But if you have 2 times a number, that number must be even, and it cannot be odd. So fy cannot be odd for any y. So the function, if it exists, must be even for all its arguments. Okay, and then we analyze f of y, and we come to the conclusion that fy can also not be even. Okay, why not? Well, suppose that fy is even. Okay, we can write every number as a binary number. So fy can also be written as a binary number. And for instance, you take the decimal number 408 minus 408, and then you can write it in the binary form, and then you get this representation. And so this is 1, 2, 4, 8 plus 16 plus 128 plus 256, which is 408. And now, If the number is even, you can very easily recognize that in the binary format, because then it ends with a zero. And then you can divide it by two by chopping off this zero, and then the remaining number is the result of a division by two. So as you can see, for every possible number that is not zero, you get that that there must be a finite number of zeros you could chop off, and then you end up with a one. But if you have a one, then it must be odd. So to phrase that a bit differently, every number that is even has a finite number of zeros in its final zeros in its binary representation. But if you then divide it n times by 2, and n being the number of zeros that it ends up with, you then must get an odd number. But that means that f of y minus n must be odd. But we already knew that fy never is odd. So that cannot be the case. So then only one thing remains, namely zero. So suppose we plug in zero, f zero is 2 times f, x minus 1 is minus 1. Oh yeah, that could be. What if f is always zero? Interesting. Is that then a solution? Or is that then... Is this definition? Is this a definition? Well, there exists a function, namely the function in which every number is zero. Well, then obviously, if this is a zero, well then 2 times a zero is also a zero. So then the specification holds. Interesting. Okay, so let's have another look at the definition. Suppose we define fx to be the following. If x is 0, we say it's 1. If x is positive, then we say it's 2 times fx minus 1. And if x is negative, then we say it's 2 times x plus 1. So you can imagine this as if you draw the graph. Right? So then the horizontal line is x, and then the vertical line is f of x. And then, okay, so we need to have a point at 0 to be 1. And then whenever we go further away in the positive, I don't know which direction, whether the webcam is mirrored or not. But let's say this is the positive part. Then that should exponentially grow. Eh? Because we start with 1, and the next one must be 2 times 1, and the next one must be 2 times 2 times 1, 2 times 2 times 2 times 1. So it's all the power of 2. And on the other side, it's also the power of 2, because we start at 1. And whenever we go to minus 1, then it's 2 times 1. Whenever we go to minus 2, it's 2 times 2 times 1. So this definition, this specification is a definition. There exists a function, it's unique, because it's the same as this function. Okay, interesting. So that's how we can define functions. Now, then you can ask yourself the general question, given a function specification. Is it now the case that there is a function that satisfies this specification? And so for an arbitrary specification you can give, does there exist a function that satisfies the specification? This is the problem. And as soon as you know, yes, there is a function and it's unique, you can define it that way. And if you don't know, then what do you do? Well, you have to, figure it out. Now, you could ask yourself, okay, given a function specification, can we maybe automatically figure out whether it's suitable for a definition because there exists a function? Now, this is quite a difficult problem. Is it always the case that for arbitrary function specification we could automatically find out whether it is usable that function specification is usable as a definition because the function exists. And I'm not talking about the uniqueness part yet, just about the existence here. But can we already figure that automatically out? Well, this was a question that also logician, mathematical logician Alonzo Church, in a different format, of course, asked. And in answering this question, he needed to have a model of computation. Right? By what do you mean automatically? And for that, he invented the lambda calculus. And then using the lambda calculus, he solved a number of outstanding issues. Namely, is it possible to automatically check, for instance, whether a specification is always true, universally valid? And that is very much related to the previous problem, the previous slide. And now it turns out, no, you cannot automatically find out whether a particular specification is always true, universally valid. Furthermore, he had very interesting results in the undecidability, as that is called, of piano arithmetic. And this undecidability here is very much related to this notion of an undecidable language. Eh? So a language is decidable whenever there exists a program that always halts, and the program outputs a one if the string of symbols is in the formal language, and it outputs a zero if it's not. Now, by saying piano arithmetic is undecidable, then it means that properties formulated in the language of piano arithmetic, so for instance, x plus y equals z, well, that's obviously not universally valid because you can find assignments of the variables that is that make them false. But there are still lots of mathematical problems that are not solved that can be formulated in that language. And and that turns out not to be automatable. So that's a pity, you cannot solve every problem with a computer. Okay, well, but how did he prove this? Well, for proving these very important results, he therefore invented the lambda calculus as a formal model, as a mathematical construction, as a formalism for modeling computation. So as part of the assignments of this course, we will be implementing an interpreter for the lambda calculus, so you have some practical experience with it. It's a very, very simple programming language. And it involves very important concepts that other programming languages also include. So, but the introduction of lambda calculus will be split over 2 weeks, so further more explanation about it will be done next week, but let's start with its grammatical structure. In the previous video you have seen BNF, so now let's use BNF to specify what is the grammatical structure of expressions in the lambda calculus. So first of all, let's assume that we have some kind of a lexical analysis that can recognize variables. So on the slide I just write x, y, z. You can imagine that strings of alphabetic characters or alphanumerical characters can be used as variables. Okay, so the non-terminal var represents variables. So then let's define the expressions to be either variables, single standing variables. And just like with the arithmetical expressions to resolve ambiguity, we allow parenthesized expressions, so that's expressions surrounded by parentheses. But the most important grammatical constructs are the abstraction construct, which is written by a lambda symbol followed by a variable, then a dot, and then an expression, a lambda expression again. An expression in the lambda calculus, sorry. So this is an abstraction. This is called an abstraction. Or an application. And an application is two expressions that are juxtaposed, so put together. And you may put a space in between or not. It depends on whatever details you want to engage in. But let's say if you put two lambda expressions next to each other, then it is called an application, And whenever you write a lambda and then a followed by a variable and a dot and then an expression, that's called abstraction. Okay, so examples that are recognized by or generated by this grammar are the following. And so you can have single standing variables like x, or you have two variables, say x and y, that are then applied. So that's this form here. So we apply x, so we apply y to x in this case, okay. Or you have three variables. Hey, this might be an ambiguous expression, because how do you apply it? It's a binary operator, it takes two expressions. But either we first apply y to x and then apply z to the result, so we parenthesize it like so. Or we first apply z to y, and then the result of that we apply to x. So that is parenthesized like so. So which one do we choose for this? Okay, let's leave that open. Another example would be abstraction. So here's an abstraction, lambda x dot x, okay? And then we can have lambda x dot x application y. Hey, maybe this is also an ambiguous expression. Do we mean here to first do the lambda abstraction and then have that the x is within the lambda abstraction? Or do we mean, oh, that's not written here. It's not written here, the alternative. Because this one with the parentheses on the outer is just the same as this one. Oh, this is not a good example. Do we mean to group the XY application underneath the abstraction? Just like we have written it here, these brackets here. Yeah, so that's a good question. How do you resolve these ambiguities? Now, and this can be done as follows. Let's say that we say that the application associates to the left. So that means that x, y, z, this one is interpreted by associating to the left. So the left one is, you group it to the left. And abstraction, lambda abstraction, so this lambda variable dot expression, it's a unary operator, if you look from the perspective of expressions. This one is preceding application. So that means that whenever you see this lambda x apply y, then it should be interpreted as if this one was bracketed first. Yeah, and so if you want to override that and you want to have that x and y are, so that y is applied to x and only then you have the abstraction, then you need to write brackets around them here. Okay, so I have not said anything about the meaning of this grammar. Anything at all, so that is still mystery to you, but you might want to read in the literature, especially the chapter by Mitchell, more about the lambda calculus, also more about partial functions, definitions, and then we will continue with this subject next week. Thank you for watching this video, and I hope to see you soon again.